Hi, I'm Dr. Mimi Guarneri, and it is my pleasure to welcome you to the Pacific Pearl La Jolla Legacy Series. This series is about bringing luminaries of health and healing to the forefront, individuals who have transformed the way we think about treating the whole person, body, mind, emotions, and spirit. The Legacy Series is funded by the Miraglow Foundation, thanks to grants from the Taylor Advised Endowment Fund. At Pacific Pearl La Jolla, we believe that healing people and changing lives comes from the wisdom of all global healing traditions. This series brings to you those individuals whose shoulders we stand on as we practice integrative holistic medicine today. Hi, I'm Dr. Mimi Guarneri, and welcome to the Legacy Series. Today, it's my absolute pleasure to sit here with Natasha Josefowitz, someone who I consider a true mentor for me personally. Dr. Josefowitz...
Okay, I was interrupting.
That's
sorry.
Okay.
Sorry, to begin with. I wanted her to... Okay.
Dr. Natasha Josefowitz epitomizes the term trailblazer and has spent her life as an educator both within and outside of academia. She was born in Paris, France in 1926 and came to the United States at 12 years old with her Russian-born parents in 1939. She has a master's degree that she attained at the age of 40 and a Ph.D. at the age of 50. In 1980, she wrote Paths to Power, A Woman's Guide from First Job to Top Executive, which quickly became a best-selling guide for women in the workplace. She taught the first college course in the country on women in management. She has hosted her own television segment, and she has appeared regularly on national public radio and television talk shows. She is a best-selling author, and I believe has written over 20 business and poetry books. I can't tell you how thrilled I am to have Natasha here with us.
I can't tell you how thrilled I am to be sitting with you, Mimi.
Yeah, you are. She is a living legend and the epitome of what the Legacy Series represents. So, Natasha, I have to say, your early work, your feminist work, your teaching women how to interview for jobs, teaching women about management, the fact that you have a PhD, which was really unheard of for women in the day, as we say, has to come from your roots. Tell us about your early childhood and where you came from.
Well, my parents were immigrants, and so we spoke Russian at home. And my parents believed that education means speaking languages. So they were totally clued out. I had a wet nurse who spoke Russian. When I was three, I spoke Russian. So one day she disappears, and I have a German Fräulein who doesn't speak anything but German. I can't imagine how traumatic that must have been to have the only caretaker I knew disappears and this other person I can't speak to. So 2 years later, I speak German, and she disappears. Now I have a Madame Michel, so now I'm speaking French. And at six, I spoke three languages fluently, French, Russian, and German. So my parents thought it was a very good way to begin education. But it had an interesting downside and an upside. Because, in other words, I could figure out what it is that was really going on. And since Russian was my first language, in the playground in Paris, I was the Russian girl. Eventually, when we emigrated to America, I was the French girl. Then when I moved back to Switzerland, I was the American woman. When I left Switzerland after 10 years and went to America, I was the Swiss woman. So wherever I was, I never fit in.
Who are you?
And there's something interesting about not fitting in, because you have two choices. You can feel bad, you don't fit in, it's not going to work, and you're never going to make it. Or you do the opposite. You say, okay, I'm not fitting in the way you all are, I'm going to be different, and exaggerate the differences. And that's what I did. Also, the other question is that as a child, because I was raised with governesses, I always wanted my parents to notice me. Hey, here I am, Mom, Dad. I was an invisible child. And invisibility and not being seen or acknowledged was part of my childhood and part of, I suppose, my pain, because I always was trying to do something interesting, be funny, do something, somebody noticed me. And so I'm wondering whether some of these early tapes, and I would like people to think about this, what were the messages you heard in your family home when you were born? What were the things you were rewarded for? What were the things you were punished for? And how does that influence who you have become? So who I have become, I become visible because I was so invisible. And I'm guessing that one still tries to fix things that weren't working then. So to cut back to when I was 12, so that is immigration, none of us speak English, Ellis Island, America, we're immigrants. We were sure the war would be won by us, and we were in California when France fell. And so there we were in California, and nothing to come back to, didn't know anybody. So we have to start kind of from scratch. My parents always had trouble with languages, so we always spoke either Russian or French at home. But I went to Beverly High, and there are two things that happened to me in my early childhood and later in Beverly Hills that I think marked me. In Paris at the time, they had movies for children, and then they had an intermission in the second movie. And during intermission, they had children recite poetry. And so a lot of the little children were reciting Victor Hugo or whatever. And I recited a poem I had written. And I got first prize. And that was the first time I ever got any attention. And so, reciting poetry, somebody applauds. This is a good thing. The next thing that happened of that kind of an event was in high school, because I didn't speak English very well, I had a very thick accent, I took a radio class, and in the radio class, I was always assigned the role of the crazy witch or the stupid gypsy or whatever, because I had this accent. And they had a contest when I was a senior in high school in dramatic declamation. I won the dramatic declamation. That was the second time I thought, radio is fun, and dramatic declamation I can do. And so I think that propelled me to have all the fun I'm having by being able to be out there and being actually outrageous. You know, as an early feminist, you need to be outrageous or nobody pays attention. You remain invisible. I taught this first course. I was at the University of New Hampshire. I was a professor of business. Actually, I want to say I'm a fake because I'm really a clinical social worker, licensed social worker. I did my internship in psychiatry at Mount Hospital. But I was teaching casework by the case method. And in the School of Business, you teach by the case method. So I was married to my first husband, Sam Josefowitz, and we were living in Switzerland. And I was part of a psychiatric team in a child guidance clinic when I met this man by the name of Dr. Herman Gaden, who was sent by Harvard to start a business school there. He had done this in Tehran, in Calcutta, in Amsterdam. And he was asked to be a consultant for a premier unit in Lausanne, Switzerland, which was having a lot of turnover, and he needed a social worker. So we were introduced and we became a team. Well, we worked together for a year and a half, working all over Switzerland, even going to France as a team. And we fell madly in love. He was married 25 years. I was married 25 years. We couldn't live without each other. So he left his wife. I left my husband. And he was starting a business school, part of a team at University of New Hampshire. He asked me to follow him. And that's how I became a professor of business. Actually, this is a secret that will no longer be a secret. My students, my business students, all became good caseworkers, which is what a good manager should be anyway. But they don't know that. I was a closet social worker.
I love it. That's great.
So the reason I taught this course Because I'm the only woman in a college of business, young women would come to me with questions. And one of the questions they had when they were being interviewed for jobs, they would be asked illegal questions like, are you going to get married? Illegal question. Or you have children? Illegal question. And they would say, no, I'm committed to a career. And four of them were asked, what method of contraception do you use?
Well, what year was this? You have to tell us what year this was.
1974, 75,
that's
76.
That's not that long ago. That 1974 is not that long ago.
All these years, this is when this was going on. And so I would say, why don't you say to your interviewer, it's a very interesting question. What does your company suggest to its employees? So that you answer a question with a question, or you say something which is not going to be, this is an illegal question, because you won't be hired, you're a troublemaker. So many of them were having issues that I thought women are having different issues than men in my management classes. I was teaching in the MBA, the advanced management class. So I asked the UNH, University of New Hampshire Senate, if I could teach a class for women in management. I thought they needed a totally different approach. And so that was allowed, and I'm looking for material. Nothing. It's the first class of women
exist.
In management, and so I'm making it up as I go along. I'm making it up, you know, how do you do a resume? How do you do an interview? How do you deal with sexist comments? This is your first day on the job. You're the only woman there. You become a manager. You become a CEO. I mean, I have the whole lifespan and how you as a woman in mostly male-dominated organizations manage. So several months into this course, some man comes and talks to secretaries, what are you typing? And my secretary showed him my material. This was Addison Wesley, and I got a contract for a book I was not writing. And that turned out to be Path to Power, A Woman's Guide from First Job to Top Executive, came out in 1980, Addison Wesley. So now I have the only book out that deals with women entering all these male-dominated organizations. She won't believe this. I am now a consultant to the FBI, the CIA, General Motors, IBM, all over. I'm all over the place consulting about this. And one of the things that I notice is that being the only woman and the first woman very often, you have to do something extraordinary, different, whatever. I'll give you an example. This is Sylvania Corporation in Boston. I'm asked by Robert Reed, that's not his real name, I don't know whether he would want it. Let's say Robert Reed says, come and talk to all of my heads of departments and see if you can sell them a seminar on how to help women entering these factories and male-dominated organizations. I say, sure. So I go in. He says, there's a board meeting. They're all sitting there. Go to the head of the table. That's where I usually sit. So, okay. So I go. I sit down. They keep talking to each other like I'm not there. Saying, and this isn't working.
And you're the only woman in the room.
Yeah, there are all these suits. And Robert Reed is standing there against the wall looking me over. Okay, so I'm thinking, this isn't working. So a man comes in late and says, oh, what's going on here? So I said, I'll tell you what's going on here. I had a sex change operation. My name is Roberta Reed, and I'm in charge today. They listened.
Good for you.
They listened. So, you know, I did things like this to make a difference. I was once, can I tell you stories like this?
Yes, okay. Of course.
For instance, all the police chiefs of the area here were meeting together again with me as the speaker to talk about harassment issues. And a young reporter comes, cute little woman in a red suit and a very short skirt. And you know when you cross your legs with a short skirt, you can see up to Kazoo. Okay. So she's sitting there. And I'm saying, do you mind if I use you? No. Okay, so don't uncross your legs, freeze. I'm going to use you. So, okay. So I'm talking with the chiefs of police, and we talk about issues of harassment and what the intent is and what the perceptions are. And I say, look at her. They all stand up and they look at her. And they say, what is her message? Oh, she's hot. She wants it. So I turn to her and I said, did you know you were hot and you wanted it? And she's flushed. She says, No. Oh, my God. I said, you see, she has no intentions, and you read intentions.
Exactly.
How, this is what we're really dealing with. And then I realized that we really needed to do something more, because that was in the 80s. A lot of harassment was going on.
Yeah.
And so I'm now the sexual harassment expert for the city of San Diego. And this is what I did. I had all the men on the left side of the room and all the women on the right side. I had the mayor, I had Chief Colander, I had the chief of police, the fire chief, I had everybody was sitting, and all the women here. Okay, so I tell the men, you are an unwed mother in your mid-80s. You need to put food on the table. These are hard times. You need the job. I tell the women, you're a mid-level manager. You see this cookie coming. I mean, her skirt is up, her blouse is down, her boobs are coming out. I mean, she wants it. Get her into bed. And so all the women go over to the men and start harassing them. They caress their thighs. These hands shouldn't be typing. Come to my apartment. Whatever. The men go into female behavior, fiddling with their ties, crossing and uncrossing their legs. In fact, Chief Colander comes up to me and says, I don't know what to do. I said, I'm not your Jewish mother. Go back there. So what is interesting is at the end of those sessions, the men said, we understand it is not about sex. It is about power. And because if it's in your head, you think, oh, she can't take a joke. But if you live this in your gut, you realize how uncomfortable they felt, how depowered they felt. They felt if they said no, they would lose their job. They didn't want to say yes. So they got it. What I did not expect, and I did that workshop, American Management Association asked me to do that workshop all over the country. What I did not understand and what the women said, we didn't know it was so much fun. And the more they harassed, the more the men looked uncomfortable, the more they had fun doing it. Power. Yeah, it's not sex. It's power issues. So I'm telling stories of what was going on in those days where you really had to do something a little out of the ordinary. Otherwise, I mean, for instance, I was asked to give a talk in Texas. This is early 1980s. And they said, please, in your topic, don't say the words women and power in one line, because none of the corporations will send their women then. So there was a very strong feeling at the time that, no, we don't want this. And so you had to go over the barrier. So what I did, I started writing funny poetry, and I tell you why. If you're the enemy, you stand there and you're going to tell them that they're doing it all wrong, right? It doesn't work.
That doesn't work, right?
No.
We know that. Mm-hmm.
And so you have to be on their side. You have to be with them. You have to be their ally. And so I started writing little verses. I'll give you some examples. Dual career family. When he brings home the bacon, she fries it. When she brings home the bacon too, they eat out. Or titles. My grandmother was a lady. My mother is one of the girls. I'm a woman. My daughter's a doctor. Or let's see another one, Pygmalion. He taught her everything he knew, and now that she knows as much as he does, he doesn't like it. And so I would write these funny little poems, and then people would laugh, and the men who were sitting like this would eventually uncross their arms.
But they had a powerful message.
And I could reach them yeah. and talk about what it is I wanted to talk about. By the way, a funny thing happened with these poems. Wherever I went, I would write a poem for whatever the occasion was. And some woman in New Jersey showed my poems to her neighbor. And the neighbor calls me up and says, my name is Freda Isaacson. I'm the senior editor of Warner Books. I took some of your poems. All the secretaries wanted to have copies. Will you be Warner Books' first poet? Oops. Me? Poet? Okay. And the book turned out to be, Is This Where I Was Going? No, I Have Arrived. Is This Where I Was Going? Broke all publishing records for a first book of poetry. I'm now a poet. So I continued writing funny poetry because with a poem, you can say things in kind of in private that you could not say publicly if it was not in poetry form. It's very interesting how what poetry can do. So I've been writing poetry.
It's so, like your form of passive resistance.
It is. That's correct.
It yes. really is, and yes. it's very creative. So, so tell us about what it was like, because there will be a lot of people who have lived through this time, but we have a lot of young viewers. Give us a little insight into what it was like to be a woman in the workplace during the 70s, let's say, or early 80s.
The first day I was as a professor, University of New Hampshire, a professor stops me in the hallway. Oh, he says, honey, you're new. Would you fax this for me? And I say, I'd be happy to. And when I have something to fax, will you fax it for me? He says, what is this? Why are you saying this? My name is Professor Josefowitz. Oh, I'm sorry. You know, a lot of that kind of stuff. A lot of not being visible. A lot of jokes. And what are the choices? You can't say, this is a bad joke, a sexist joke. You go along. You go along with the guys. On the other hand, this is what happened to me last week. I'm at a board meeting, and a woman next to me, a doctor, says to me, you know, I go to medical, this is last month. I go to medical meetings, I say something which I think is significant, drops. 2 seconds later, a man says the same thing. Oh, as Dr. So-and-so said, what do you do? That was happening in the 80s, it has happened today.
Absolutely, 100%.
And so, what do? You make allies. You can't say, I said it first. You can't do that. So you make an ally. When you lock eyes with your ally, who then says, oh, that's exactly what Natasha had said, or what Cynthia had said, or whatever. You have to make allies so that you do this for each other. You can't do it for yourself, because it's not nice. Write these concepts. Now, the most recent research, and it's disheartening. You give someone 2 resumes, John in a resume, Jane, same resume. Who do you hire? John gets hired, most always. Somehow a man is seen as more knowledgeable, more hireable. Same thing with promotions. Which one do you promote, Jane or John? Same resume, same background. When you're giving this to people, they look at the resume, they say, oh, okay, this one. So this hasn't changed. And one of the things that is really difficult to deal with is all these unconscious prejudices that women can't be as good, it can't make it. Well, there is some piece that is a reality. Women have children and they have more responsibilities. If the kid is sick, who does the school call? They call mom, they don't call dad.
Right.
And so we have to start, to make a difference, we have to start changing the culture. You have to change the culture so the school's called dad too. Now in San Francisco, for the first time, they have paternity leave. And it so happens I have a grandson in San Francisco who just had twin boys. I'm a great-grandmother.
Congratulations.
And he is on paternity leave. And so that's amazing progress. This is new. So we are progressing. It is better. Yet, you know, with, what are we, 77 cents on the dollar that men make?
Right.
And in the highest corporation levels, women are only 4% as CEOs. I mean, we've gotten better. We're not there. We're still working at it. And so, but some of the work we have to do is about the culture.
So what would you suggest? Because I talk to a lot of women and I say, do you think the Equal Rights Amendment has been passed? And they invariably say, oh yes, it's been passed. And you and I both know it has not been passed.
That's
it's
correct.
Never been passed.
That's
and
correct.
There's even a push right now to pass the
correct.
Equal Rights Amendment. I mean, something as simple as that. So part of my talking to you today, too, is to raise the level of awareness. You know, in the 60s, people took to the streets. They marched on Washington. They had microphones. They made a lot of noise. They ran around with posters. And I feel like today there's a level of complacency. And I'm wondering, what is that about? I don't see any anti-war movements. I don't see any feminist movements. They're coming in on paper and on the internet, but there's not that hardcore messaging that we had years ago.
I have, my work now is to make the unconscious conscious.
Great.
It's the only thing you can actually do because the prejudices are unconscious. And as long as they're unconscious, you can't deal with them. You cannot deal with your unconscious because you don't know you're being prejudiced. So you have to make the prejudice known, and then you can look at it. In other words, these people who all took John instead of Jane in their resume, you then show them both resumes, and you say, this is what you did. They were not aware when they were doing it. And so this makes them aware, oh, I am prejudiced. I mean, we all are prejudiced. We all are bigoted to some extent. I have prejudices about all kinds of stupid stuff. And I have to... Natasha, don't do that, you know?
Right, but you're aware of it, and you catch yourself.
I try to be. I'm what I'm working on now, I'm really old. I'm going to be 90. you know, that doesn't compute. So I'm working on improving. What I want to improve, become more tolerant and more compassionate. I'll give you an example. It's stupid. I don't like older women who... talk in a little girl voice, and I kind of cute. You know, they're little ones, oh. I see a woman doing that, and I go, don't do that.
Yeah.
It's a prejudice.
Well, but we also have a problem in our culture where we don't recognize the wisdom that comes with age. Mm-hmm. I mean, you are the wisdom keeper. You have all this life experience. You have so much to share, lessons that we can all learn from. And yet in our culture, we treat people after they retire, here's your gold watch and take care and we'll see you later. And one of my little pet peeves is I don't like when I hear people talking to older people like they're children.
That's right.
I mean, to me, that is really disturbing.
And what are we going to do today?
Right.
No, a nurse to an older woman. Yeah, that's right. That's right. But this is beginning to be talked about. One of the things I think we should also pay attention to is that all the people that are retiring are really a potential workforce for service. And I'll tell you what I'm talking about. You probably know that every day in America, 10,000 people become 65, join Medicare. Mm-hmm. This will continue until 2030. The segment of the population growing the fastest, 85 plus. It's a silver tsunami. It's coming.
It's here.
We don't have the infrastructure. We don't have enough young humans to take care of all these people. On one hand, and on the other hand, there's all of these factories and the robots and their jobs will be lost. You know, we're talking about robots taking over a lot of the possible jobs. We can start a service industry because these people need to be serviced. The service industry, I think, will grow. And a lot of retirement people can start really thinking about being there for other people that need them with their enough good shape to do it. Yes, I wrote a book on retirement, The Next Great Adventure. I think it is a time for us to reinvent ourselves and do maybe what we've never done before. It's time.
Well, you know, Deborah Zakei just put it beautifully. She said the first 30 years, you're getting your education.
That's
and
right.
And the next 30 years, you're raising your family, buying your house and paying your bills and getting... And then when you hit 60, that's your emancipation. That's your time to really start to do your service work, give back, do the things that speak to your soul.
That's right.
And really create your legacy. I think that what we have is, you know, you come from an incredible community of people. I know where you live at White Sands. I mean, a huge percent of the people there have higher education, right?
60% of us have advanced degrees.
Right. So I look at that and I say, well, we have a whole group of refugees that need to learn to speak English and children that need to learn to read and... I think we're missing that whole connection between what you're saying. People that are 65 or older have all this wisdom, all this to give back, and yet in our culture, I don't see us doing that.
Let me tell you about some of the basic needs that we have. I mean, besides water, food, shelter. We all have needs for security, but we also have need for variety and challenge. We have need for community, and we have need for contribution.
Yes.
We have need for learning, and these are basic needs. And so our need for contribution is the need that really can be expressed best after we have retired. We can really then push ourselves. And you know what? I know what Deborah's a good friend of mine. We're talking about this a lot, she and I, about these 60-year-olds who have done everything you've just said. And now what? Now what is the contribution? Is making a difference in other people's lives. We're right. All connected. This is the next steps for these people.
So what would you say, I just want to close the loop on the whole feminist movement.
Yes.
And how you got women into the workforce and were critical in guiding women. I mean, we take this a lot of the things for granted today that were things that you pioneered in the 70s and 80s. What would you advise women right now who are getting the $76 to the dollar pay for a male, women who can't break the glass ceiling, women that are harassed? There's still sexual harassment going on.
Yeah. There's also, San Diego.
Right. I mean, and it's all around us. And, you know, even to this day, I mean, we're talking 2016, women still hear, you asked for that harassment, or that short skirt was, you deserve that harassment.
That's right.
And there's this whole disrespect. I mean, how would you advise women?
Well, there are two sides to it. There's a woman's side, and then there's the men's side. For the woman's side, one of the things I was talking about, this is in the 70s and 80s, how we look. And I want to show you. This is one look. And a lot of women are like this. They don't want to be too visible, and they don't want to make fuss. And when you are sitting like this, the brain thinks that you're not very confident and you don't feel confident. So even though you feel like this, you're now in a hostile environment. Look people in the eye. You sit always straight. I, in fact, tell people sit on the arms of chairs if you're a short woman. I'm not even 5 feet. Sit on the arms of chair. Wear red. Mm-hmm. Look at people in the eye. Shake hands, be the first to ask a question. In other words, make yourself. Now, of course, you know what happens. If you're assertive, you're seen as aggressive, you know?
I have to tell you, I just have to stop because I've lived through a lot of this. And I always say, if I'm a woman in a meeting talking about business or having, just like you said, you lay out the whole plan and no one sort of hears it, and then a guy picks it up, and everybody hears it. But of course, if we say something that's that may be not agreeable or a different premise, we're called witches. There are some other names that we won't say on the camera that go along with, rhyme with witch. Mm-hmm. And, this is our reality right now.
It is. It has been. It is. It's a little better. So one part of it, we need to do our part, which is all we can do. The other part of it, we really, really need to work with the men about all this. Now, I was asked for many years at UCSD, they were having a class on international studies. And I was always asked to come on the first day of the class because there were a lot of international students. And international students really have been, they really demean women because in their culture, women, you know. And so I would make groups of men and groups of women and talk about some of the issues that, these issues, right, of how they don't listen to women, how women are not taken into their own little clubs and their own little, I was the first woman of the Rotary here.
Another first.
Yeah. And so we need work, it isn't just the women. The women can do what they can do, but we need to talk with the men and make the unconscious prejudices conscious. And I did that the first class, and that's international studies. I would work with the men. And even with the teacher, the professor, I won't say his name, the professor would call on men more than on women. And he was unaware of that. The hand of a man. Now, in kindergarten, little boys, little girls until they don't know whether it's going to be okay what they say. You know, it's already in kindergarten. It's interesting that little boys, because they have more mobility, more energy than little girls, most of them, not of course not everybody, there is a tendency for little boys to be much more upfront than little girls. You know, it's interesting. I've always thought of men and women living on two continuum. Men live on a vertical line. Who's up, who's down, who's powerful, who's not. Women live on a horizontal line. Who's close, who's far, who I can trust. It's a very different way of seeing the world and of living. And we know that in decision-making is better when women are involved. I mean, that is serious research. And so we have to prove this. I'm not saying it's easy. I'm saying we have to keep pushing. We have to keep pushing for that unconscious to be it's all unconscious prejudice.
So how can we help? I mean, you do it through poetry, and you make people laugh, and then people laugh and they realize, she's right, right? I am being prejudiced. I didn't realize it. And it comes about in a really soft kind of way because it's a poem and it's funny.
I also do joking, humor. Yeah. You have to do humor. If you tell a man who's just said something or was obvious prejudice, you say, oh my God, you are really... in the last generation, you haven't really grown at all. Oh my God, you know, realize what you just said. You know, I do that kind of thing. I mean, exaggerate and say, but then, and then say, do you get it? You know, you're never against men. You need to be an ally. You kind of hold their hand and you say, look, I know it's tough. You really would prefer to have the old boys. You know, when I got in the Rotary, there were a lot of men who quit the Rotary because they didn't want women in there. I was the first one, and I said, I don't want to be the only one with 550 men. Get another four women. So we were five. So this is the downtown Rotary, which I'm still a member every Thursday.
That's great.
Yeah, I know. This is 1987, when the Supreme Court said all the service clubs would lose their tax exempts if they don't have women there.
Yeah.
So they had to have women. So anyhow, so we were five. So the five of us were sitting together, and the men would come and say, what are you plotting? And if one of us was sitting with a lot of the men, they'd say, ah, a rose amongst the thorns. I mean, you know, stuff. Right. But it turned out that a lot of women turned out to be heads of committees there, and men realized, and there are no prejudices now at the Rotary. They're really doing well. They realize how important women are, as important as men. In fact, even maybe more so, because we do all the work.
So what would you say we need to do? Do we need to just keep pushing along with educating men? Do
yes.
we need to get women in more power positions? Do we need to get women more educating women?
Yes.
All
yes,
of this.
Yes, to everything we've been... Look, we have made progress.
We have.
We can't say we have not made progress. One of the progress we have made is that we talk about all these things differently. We do. And there is... The younger generation of men, they're more involved with fatherhood. They're more involved with families. I think they are more... part of the equation, don't you think?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. So the younger men. So I tell you what, all this old generation will die out, and then and then we'll have the young men who will be cognizant of what it is to be a father, what it is to be a husband, what to be a partner, about equality.
Absolutely. I mean, we see guys running to get the kids from daycare,
That's
getting
right.
the kids
no, no.
from school,
no,
being
I
at the appointments.
It's happening now.
Yes.
I mean, in my generation, you never saw a man with a baby.
Right.
We do.
Yes.
We do now. No, things are happening. We do have more women in places where there were none before. So I don't want to negate progress, but it's slow.
How can we support each other as women? What would you say is the most important thing there? Because I see a lot of women struggle with women, and sometimes that's a sad thing.
I did research on this. Now, tell you, because I heard that.
Yeah.
You know, my female boss is really mean to me. I heard that. And I came up with two answers. One is, there's a perception. If you have a female boss, if she's not a mother or a sister, she's a bitch. If a man is not a brother or a father to you, you don't say he's a bastard. So you have expectations from female bosses that are different than male bosses. That's one thing. The other thing is that women who have made it usually have struggled a lot to get there. And so because they have struggled to make it easy on someone else, does that take the struggle away? I was thinking about this and I thought, you know, I got my PhD at 50. It wasn't easy. It was really, really a tough go. If you would say to me, hey, Natasha, good news, PhD is now 3 months and you can have it. I'll say, that's not okay. That's not okay. I really worked hard for mine. I don't want to make it 3 months for someone else. I would immediately react instinctively that way. Protect my struggle. I think women who have made it are protecting their struggle, and I don't want to make it easy for others. I mean, some, not all.
Right.
I mean, most women are. The most important thing, the most powerful thing a woman can do, you know, we always talk, get a mentor. Most powerful thing a woman can do is to mentor other women. That is the most powerful thing anyone can do. That is what's important.
That's why I have you, and I have Deborah Zakei, and I, you know, doesn't...
That's mutual.
And Gladys
McGarry,
and I, you know, it doesn't get better than that, so...
I have you too, Mimi.
Well,
we have each other.
I'm thrilled.
Yeah.
So what would you say, if you had to pick the three guiding principles in your life, what would you say they are?
Well, you probably will think it's weird. One is identify the fear and then go there. And you really have to do that because a lot of the stuff is scary. And so you always have a choice between staying in your comfort zone and not. And I want to say something more about that. Already in kindergarten, you see little children sitting next to the teacher and not wanting to go anywhere, and they're a little shy. And other little children are running around. They have to run after them because they're all over the place. This is already a personality characteristics. Some people are more secure by not venturing out and need that kind of security. And some people are really very adventurous and are okay. So I want people to honor their own instincts. If it's really that uncomfortable for you to venture forth, so don't. But if you can, I like to try out behaviors that are not comfortable. And so this is my motto. The other motto I have, which we'll probably disagree with, but it doesn't go for doctors, and that is not everything worth doing is worth doing well. Mm. And I tell you why I say this. If you're a perfectionist, you're never really finished, and then you don't move on. A book is never finished. A poem is never finished. It gets abandoned.
Right.
You abandon things, and you don't move on.
Right.
Because you can always make everything better. And I have believed better is the enemy of good enough.
Yeah, I think that's very sage advice.
You know, and so, again, I mean, these are kind of principles I have always thought about. But there's something I want to talk to you about, and that is my husband died, that second husband that was madly in love with. We stayed in love until the day he died, which is now 7 years ago. I was in so much pain when he died that I thought, does everybody have this much pain? And you don't die of this much pain? It was awful. I thought, well, I want to find out how people in my age group deal with loss, because it's a very different age group. It is parents are dead, kids are middle-aged and have moved away, and you're not identified as a worker anymore. So you have many fewer resources. I'm going to have a drink of water.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
So here you are, much more isolated with fewer resources. How do you deal with pain? And how do you deal with healing? And so I thought I would interview. I interviewed 50 people, half men, half women, who had recently lost a spouse.
Over a certain age?
My age group, 65 plus.
Plus.
You know, retired people. And it was easy because I speak at the Rotary, I speak at the Kiwanis, I speak all over the place, and I always say anybody here would like to be interviewed, and it works. So I found things that are really interesting that was not in the literature, which are new findings, that men and women actually grieve very differently and heal very differently. I'll give you just an interesting example, and that's the culture. You ask a man, you have a friend who just lost his wife, how would you help? Oh, I would take him out for lunch, we'd play golf, we'd talk about other things. That's the response, general response. You ask a woman, you have a friend who just lost her husband, what would you do? Oh, I would come over with food and we'd sit and talk. Mm-hmm. It's a totally different approach. The men and women have different approaches of how they dealt with the death of a spouse. For instance, what's interesting, the suicide rate of men who had lost a wife is 6% higher than the general population. However, 1 year later, they are already hooked up with the best casserole.
And I see that. I see that in my practice all the time.
Yes, that's right. Also, the activity level increases, the women's activity level decreases. They don't go to grief workshops like women do. They don't talk about what is going on. They pretend that I'm fine more than women do. The eating patterns are interesting. Men will get a rotisserie chicken, stand at the kitchen counter and eat it with their hands. Women will sit down, a plate, a placemat, a glass, and very, very different way of coping with food. I thought about the difference. Well, you know, Elizabeth Kubler-Ross.
Yes, of course.
She had stages of grief, which actually were meant for people who were dying and not for people who were grieving. And the media took it for people who were grieving. Right. And it actually didn't really work that well. I thought of different stages. Well, first there's shock, where you kind of... which is good. Shock is good because it's a way for the body to protect you from being a total mess. And that is when you have to start thinking about funerals and the family and the food
right,
and everything.
Right.
Yeah.
You have to get through that.
That's right. And then there's this numbness time when you feel nothing. And you say, well, I don't know what's the matter with me. I feel nothing. And then comes a very interesting stage, which I have not seen in the literature, which I call alienation. And that happens more to women than to men. That's happened to me. People stopped inviting me. People stopped calling me. It happens to people who divorce. This has to do with the discomfort people feel with someone who is grieving. They don't know what to say. And so there's a whole list of things that I have written about my book about what you should not say. If you want to, I can talk about that. And so what it is that happens during alienation, you go to a cocktail party or anywhere, and you stand there with your glass alone, and you want to join a group, and they're all talking. It's very uncomfortable. It happens more to women than to men. And so then what you have to do, you have to reinvent yourself. You have to actually reinvent yourself as an okay single person. And then what you end up with is a new normal. It's never the old normal. Somehow anybody who's lost a spouse, I always kind of have a secret limp that isn't visible, but you know it. You're always not a couple. There, you always go to bed alone. It gets better. It is a new normal. You do manage through life, and you can have fun, and life. My life is wonderful. It's exciting. I miss him.
Absolutely.
You know? And so the book is called Living Without the One You Cannot Live Without. And it's a book of poetry that goes from the cancer diagnosis to healing in verse form. And Amazon has that.
And that's just one of the many books.
Yeah, that's my last one. That's the latest one.
So what would you say, you know, you've lived a long life and you're going strong. There's no slowing you down. You continue to do everything you want to do.
Yeah.
So what advice would you give if you had to say from a body, mind, spirit, what would you advise
whatever
people?
Whatever age you are, 20, 30, 40, doesn't matter. Start today. Live intelligently. I have lived intelligently. Now, you may think that this is, well, God, I've heard this before. Listen carefully. This is important. Whatever you do to your body now at any stage that you're in is what you do with your body forever. Mm. Your mind lives in your body. You have to take care of the body for your mind to be happy. And whatever you do to your body also does it to your mind. What am I talking about? It's not that complicated. You all know what to eat. I don't have to tell you. More vegetables, more fruit, less red meat. I don't have to tell you that. You all know it. Do it. And at first, when you go lower on sugar and lower on salt, things don't taste as good. Give it 3 weeks. Your taste buds will adjust. I really believe in conscious eating. So once in a while you can have, I have an ice cream cone and whatever. Not often. And after a while you don't miss it. So that's, I really believe in that. The other part is exercise. Yeah. You gotta keep moving, you gotta get that heart pumping. Because I tell you, every time your heart pumps, it pumps blood into your brain and it makes neurons.
And the research shows that.
Absolutely. So exercise. Get your heart pumping. Flexibility, so that when you're my age, you can do stuff. So you do this when you're 20. Then you can pick up stuff from the floor when you're 90. So never stop doing that. Strength training. Feel.
You're doing it. You're lifting weights.
12 pounds.
Beautiful.
Yeah, I do that. But then there's another piece. There's another piece which is as important as what I just talked about, is isolation. People who are living alone have a much harder time being healthy, and it has to do with earlier death, more illness than people who are in community. Let me give you some statistics. The immune system is predicated on the number of people you encounter in any 24-hour period. So if you're alone and you have to make a phone call, you want to have lunch, well, maybe next week. You have to have friends, you have to join groups, you have to be in a community. And the most important thing is if you can be in a community where you contribute something, and I'll tell you why. And it is, what doesn't work is if you're in a different organization every day and you give something here and you will go there and you go there, that doesn't work. It has to be in the same place where you form a community of like-minded people and where you have a group you belong to, belonging. It is part of the, as important for us as food and shelter and everything else. And so community, exercise, food, community.
So you just described all the principles of integrative holistic medicine.
Well, of course.
Right? It's the what you eat, who you eat with, your activity, how you respond to stress and tension, having joy in your life, having a purpose in life. I mean, these are all the guiding principles and that we teach every day.
But you know what? We all know it. I am not saying anything none of you have not heard. You've all heard it. It's not news. News is start today. Really. I tell you what, I'll make a deal with you. Whoever you are, you listen to. You start thinking that you can't do it or it's difficult, call me. I'm at White Sands. Say, Natasha, you get to me. I'm happy to talk to anybody who has trouble doing any of these things because I'm really a believer that you can make your life what you want it to be.
And you're telling everyone, take the first step.
That's right.
It's in your hands.
Yes.
We're all empowered to take
that first
step. I want
to help you.
And you have helped. You've helped enormously through all your books, through your life. So now your 90 is coming upon us. And I know you have a whole plan. So can you share some of that? What do you see as the next highlights?
Okay. I'm in a transition time. This is what I've done all my life. I've been driven, actually, because it's been exciting. And I do stuff, and I run around, and whatever. I read a book by an old Greek philosopher from 2,000 years ago, Epicurus, and he said one sentence which really hit me. He said, honor your old age. I'm thinking, oh, what's that? I'm not honoring anything. I'm not honoring my old age.
How do I honor it?
No. What does that mean? It means that, well, you know, I probably have less than a decade left. And so I know what I've done all my life. What am I going to do next? What is going to be important? What is it that I haven't done that I still want to do? So these are the questions we all have to ask ourselves when we have some certain amount of years left. What are we going to do with these years? So I don't want to play golf. I was thinking I might want to learn the piano. No, but I have no talent. That's not going to work. So what is it? And so this is where Deborah Zeki and I started talking, she and I. She's 94. I'm going to be 90. I'm going to be 90 on Halloween. I'm a certified witch.
Oh, we have a good party at the Academy right here at our big conference for you to come to.
Big party. So what is it that we can still do? And we're thinking of doing something together, she and I. Talk to the people who are in that group that you first mentioned, past 60, past 70, who are at that time in their lives. What is it that we can still all do together? How is it that we're going to be such a huge group? You know, this is the baby boomer curve. This is the curve. The curve is now moving. It's coming in. And so this is my daughter. My daughter's 65. So what is it that we do that we can do with help that curve? And this is what she and I are talking about. Maybe make a difference in that silver tsunami that's coming in.
Well, that's the plan. That could be powerful. Well,
yeah, we'll see. We're going to do it. We're going to work together. It's fun.
I think it's terrific.
Yeah.
Anything else you'd like to add before we close?
Well, we've all been there. We've all done that. And now is the time to do something new and different. Let's all do it together. Let's make a difference. Each one of us can make a difference. The secret is doing it with someone and for someone every day. I always think about doing an unexpected kindness. I tell you what I do. When I'm in the checkout counter at Vaughn's, and there's this harried woman there in the cashier, I stop and say, I like your hair today, really, or you're very pretty, or you're doing this so well. I say something to break up the thing. Everybody is having a tough time.
Yeah.
You know, all around us, people are having a tough time. I do things like, I don't know, you may think it's nuts. I walk by some woman that I don't know, and I said, I love the way you walk. And pass by, and I don't even stop. Or you look so pretty today, or whatever. I say things to people a lot, because everybody's struggling with something. And just a word sometimes just makes you feel better for a minute.
Yeah.
And do every day an unexpected kindness.
I think that's a beautiful way to close. To be compassionate, to
tolerant.
Pay it forward, tolerant.
Loving. Love. We haven't talked about love.
It's the most important thing.
That's what, you know, we all only vibrating molecules.
Yeah.
We have to love each other. Mimi, I love
you. I love you too.
I know.
Yeah. And, you know, love is the greatest healer.
That's right.
And love is the message. So
that's right.
Thank you so much.
Love and you'll be loved.
Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That's